Hi, it's Katrina. Brain-invading tapeworm. Spirometra arena something something is a tapeworm from Asia that rarely invades the human body, instead typically infecting carnivores such as cats and dogs. Only about 300 human cases have been reported since 1953. Several years ago, a 50-year-old Chinese man reported to a UK hospital with complaints of headaches, seizures, memory flashbacks, and an altered sense of smell and taste. Doctors ruled out tuberculosis, HIV, Lyme disease, and syphilis. An MRI showed an abnormality and a biopsy detected inflammation, but no tumor. For the next 4 years, MRIs showed that the abnormal region was actually moving around in the man's brain. Medical professionals didn't know what was going on, so they finally decided to operate. They removed a 1 centimeter long tapeworm unlike any other ever seen in the UK. The creature was shipped to the Wellcome Sanger Institute in Cambridge for genetic testing and was identified as a Spirometra something-something specimen. This species is usually found in China, South Korea, Japan, and Thailand, but like many diseases and parasites, global travel enabled it to spread outside its native region. It does not always invade the brain and has been discovered under the skin, in the lungs, and a few other places. Sorry. The creature's presence in the man's brain easily explains his symptoms, which changed as it migrated around the organ. Because brain tissue is rich in fatty acids, which the tapeworm absorbs through its skin, it's an ideal living environment for the invasive pest. Yikes, right? The team at the Sanger Institute sequenced the tapeworm's genome and noticed that it's about 10 times larger than the genomes of other tapeworms that have been examined. This perhaps explains why the species invades and thrives in many different animals. It's also resistant to a traditional antiparasitic medication, but as this case proves, sometimes surgical removal is necessary. Botfly larva. If you have a sensitive stomach, this is not the video for you. You have been warned, my friends. When a 17-year-old boy from Pozuzo, Peru experienced a swollen left eye for several weeks, he went to the Children's Hospital in Lima to try getting to the bottom of the issue. An MRI revealed that there was a 1.2-inch worm living in his eye. Suspecting it was a botfly larva, an ophthalmologist and her assistants painstakingly removed the thing, which turned out to be a creature, from the teen's eye using basil leaves and tweezers. Around 40 different mosquito species are known to transmit human botflies. Mosquitoes deliver and implant eggs into humans by dropping them onto the body and then biting into the person to feed, causing the eggs to drop into the skin. Larvae grow inside the body for about 8 weeks before emerging. In some cases, an infestation is relatively harmless, depending on where it occurs, but in others, it can lead to serious consequences. In this case, the patient was at risk of having an infection spread to his brain. Doctors use basil leaves to lure larvae out of the body because they are attracted to the smell. In situations where the bodily opening is too small for the worm to exit on its own, like with the boy from Peru, tweezers or other invasive methods are required to complete the job. Aural miasis. Miasis is the medical term for a maggot infestation in the human body. Aural miasis pertains to an infestation in the external and/or middle ear. It can happen to anyone, but is more common among mentally and physically disabled individuals, children, and people with impaired personal hygiene. Doctors typically treat this condition by removing the larva from the infected site and cleaning it. Without treatment, aural miasis can be life-threatening. In one case report detailed in the journal Northern Clinics of Istanbul, a bedridden 87-year-old dementia patient's left ear itched constantly for a month, then started bleeding. Doctors discovered that her left external ear canal was full of live fly larvae. They sprayed the maggots with a lidocaine solution to restrict their movements and removed 7 of them total, one by one, with the help of a microscope. The creatures averaged in length from 10 to 15 millimeters. Luckily, the procedure was successful and the woman was okay. While people who can't effectively communicate or care for themselves are at a higher risk for aural miasis, like one 92-year-old Illinois Alzheimer's patient who couldn't convey her discomfort when her ear contained 57 maggots, nobody is immune to having a fly lay eggs in their ear. One young man from India went to Dr. Vikram Yadav complaining of buzzing in his ear, and it was chock full of fly larvae. It's likely that a housefly laid eggs in his ear while he was sleeping. Dr. Yadav suffocated the squirming creatures, causing them to emerge to the surface, picked them out of the man's ear individually, and applied an antiparasitic medication. Wow. And now for number 6. But first, let me know your scary experience with bugs in the comments below. And be sure to subscribe if you haven't already. Cockroach. An Australian man named Hendrik Helmer woke up one morning in early 2014 with sharp, agonizing pain in his right ear. The pain worsened between intermittent periods of relief and eventually became unbearable. At one point, if Helmer was standing up when a jab of pain hit, it caused him to hunch over and drop to the ground. Thinking a spider had burrowed into his ear canal while he slept, the Darwin resident tried flushing his ear out with water and sucking the creature out with a vacuum. Would you do this? I don't know. Not only were these methods unsuccessful, they seemed to anger whatever was inside Helmer's ear. He went to the Royal Darwin Hospital where a doctor poured olive oil down his ear, causing the intruder to burrow deeper before it finally drowned. Oh my gosh. Near the 10-minute mark, somewhere about there, he started to stop burrowing, but he was still in the throes of death twitching, Helmer told ABC Radio Darwin. Then, using forceps, the doctor extracted a 2-centimeter cockroach from the man's ear. Helmer experienced some short-term side effects like difficulty balancing and jaw pain, but was expected to fully recover and was surprisingly not traumatized by the incident. Thank goodness! This is pretty terrifying! Unfortunately, this wasn't a one-off occurrence. In India in early 2017, a 42-year-old woman named Selvi went to the hospital complaining of severe discomfort. "I could not explain the feeling, but I was sure it was some insect," Selvi told the New Indian Express. "There was a tingling, crawling sensation. Whenever it moved, it gave me a burning sensation in my eyes." It turned out to be a fully grown cockroach, which entered the woman through her nasal cavity and lodged itself between her eyes, at the base of her skull and near her brain. Thankfully, the specimen was removed using a combination of suction and forceps, although it was a bit reluctant to come out. Would you get over it if a cockroach took up residence in your ear, or would you be scarred for life? Let me know in the comments below. Sea snail, knee snail. A little boy from Aliso Viejo, California named Paul Franklin scraped his knee against a rock during a family camping trip in July 2013. His father, Ken Franklin, told KCAL that he cleaned and bandaged Paul's wound. It didn't seem serious. After all, it's pretty normal for little boys to get cuts and scrapes. But Paul's seemingly minor injury persisted for weeks and became swollen and infected. "I came home and his knee was the size of an orange and hot to the touch, and he's limping," Paul's mother, Rachel, explained. That was when the little boy's parents decided to take him to urgent care, where a doctor diagnosed him with a possible staph infection and prescribed antibiotics. The medications helped at first, but Paul's wound ultimately worsened and eventually started turning black. Rachel drained the wound by squeezing it with her fingers until it popped. What looked like a strange black rock emerged from Paul's skin. Upon closer examination, Rachel realized it was a sea snail. The family was relieved to finally know what was wrong with their son, concluding that a snail egg must have gotten into his knee when he scraped it, and Paul's injury rapidly healed after it was removed. The preschooler also took the ordeal in stride, telling CNN, "I thought it was kind of crazy." Disaster in paradise. Canadian couple Eddie Zeitner and Katie Stevens returned to their home in Windsor, Ontario with extremely itchy feet after a vacation in the Dominican Republic in early 2018. "We were scratching our toes for almost the duration of the trip," Zeitner told CNN. 4 days after arriving back in Canada, blisters developed and the couple's feet swelled. Their pain also worsened, forcing them to use crutches, and they couldn't stand the touch of shoes or even socks. It took multiple hospital visits for doctors to finally diagnose the pair with a parasitic skin infection called cutaneous larva migrans, which is caused by hookworm larvae burrowing into the skin. They probably acquired the infection while walking barefoot on the Punta Cana shore. Hookworm larvae dwell primarily in the intestines of wild animals, as well as dogs and cats. The parasite spreads to humans who come into contact with feces-contaminated sand and soil. It usually only survives in humans for up to 6 weeks. Oh, that's a relief. And eventually goes away on its own, but antiparasitic medications can be helpful in speeding the process along, according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. While these medications are available in the US without a prescription, they are only accessed in Canada on a case-by-case basis. The Canadian government initially denied Stevens and Zeitner's request for the medications, but they eventually got their hands on it via a doctor who was dual-certified in Canada and the US. Thank goodness! After being diagnosed, Stevens took to Facebook with gruesome photos of her and Zeitner's afflicted feet, pleading with beachgoers not to forget footwear and to use caution at the beach. I don't know about you, but after hearing their story, I will certainly heed these warnings. Giant kidney worm. In late 2015, a 76-year-old Czech woman named Hena Foldinova went to the hospital at her doctor's urging after he discovered blood in her urine. Thinking it was a blood clot, emergency room doctors performed surgery, only to discover a 10-centimeter worm living in the woman's kidney, as well as a 6-centimeter worm in her bladder. They removed both specimens and identified the one from her kidney as Dioctophimi renale, or a giant kidney worm, which is relatively common in canines but rarely infects humans. Giant kidney worms are only removable through surgery and become life-threatening when left untreated. Unfortunately for Foldinova, the invasive inhabitants had weakened her body, and she ultimately succumbed to their damage. Head urologist at Krnov Hospital, Dr. Ivo Odestrel, explained in a CEN interview that while doctors were unsure how the giant kidney worm entered Foldinova's body, human infections are typically caused by eating undercooked fish. The woman's family confirmed that she frequently enjoyed local seafood, strongly indicating that this was the cause. Foldinova's case is the only recorded instance of giant kidney worm infestation of a human in the Czech Republic. The parasite can survive inside the human body for up to 5 years. Scar-dwelling spider. In Bali, Indonesia, a spider crawled into Australian vacationer Dylan Maxwell's appendectomy scar and traveled up his torso, creating an irritated red trail that started blistering. He sought medical care and was prescribed an antihistamine for what the doctor thought was an insect bite. But the pain didn't subside. In fact, it worsened, as an irritated red trail continued forming, eventually spanning from his navel to his chest. Maxwell described his pain to the 7 Network as a very searing, hot, searing, burning sensation. It was like nothing I felt before. After returning to Australia, the man sought a second medical opinion. Doctors made a small incision in his stomach and found a spider and removed it, which had been living underneath his skin for 3 days. Many skeptics doubted the validity of Maxwell's story, including some experts who said there is no established history of spiders burrowing into people's skin. Snopes ultimately classified the story as probably false, but this also means that there is a slim margin of doubt in Maxwell's favor. What do you think? Parasitic squid pregnancy. In June 2012, a 63-year-old woman ate parboiled Japanese flying squid in South Korea and felt a pricking and foreign body sensation as she bit down, according to a paper published in the Journal of Parasitology. According to the study, as soon as she put a piece into her mouth, she felt like many bugs were biting her oral mucosa. She probably didn't say it like that. The woman immediately spat out the squid due to the severe pain, but by then, the damage was done. Doctors removed 12 small, white, spindle-shaped, bug-like organisms stuck inside her mouth. Good thing she caught it early. They were essentially parasite-like bags of squid semen, which doctors identified as spermatophores. They are not fully formed organisms with eyes, legs, or tentacles, but they are complex, and they continued squirming around even after they were extracted from the woman's mouth. Another documented case happened the previous year in 2011, when a 21-year-old woman consumed a squid's sexual organs and felt a similar stinging sensation. Consumption of a squid with sperm bags and an active ejaculatory apparatus can lead to unintended ejection of the sperm bag and injury to the oral mucosa, according to a 2011 study in Pathology International analyzing the woman's case. There's some extra reading for you right before bedtime. As I'm sure you've gathered by now, eating raw or undercooked seafood causes this ailment. The moral of the story? Eat it at your own risk. Pygmy woolly mammoth. In 2018, a possible new species of mini mammoth was uncovered. Unearthed on Kotelny Island in Siberia, experts believe the remains could be nearly 50,000 years old. The bright yellow color of its fur earned the animal the nickname of Golden Mammoth. Its small stature has led some to believe that it may be a member of an unknown species. At roughly 7 feet tall, the adult carcass measures less than half the height of a normal woolly mammoth. One of its tusks is fully intact, while the other has been cut off somehow. Dr. Albert Proto-Popov, the renowned paleontologist famous for studying many frozen animals in Siberia, stresses that it is the carcass of an adult, not a young mammoth, and stated plans for the remains to be excavated in the near future. Until this discovery, the only other remains of mini mammoths that had been discovered were just bones. Proto-Popov theorizes that small mammoths once occupied the remote island, since other remains have also been found. He believes that the recently discovered carcass comes from the heyday of the woolly mammoth, when significantly rising numbers of the animal led to their greatest ever diversity. Ancient viruses. Great, something else we have to worry about! Viruses that have been frozen in time that might any day be released into the modern world. In 2015, American and Chinese scientists went to Tibet and collected samples of the world's oldest glacial ice. They obtained two 15,000-year-old ice cores from 164 feet down and decontaminated the samples. Microbiology techniques revealed 33 virus groups, including 28 never-before-seen ancient viruses. The team recently published their findings to share them with the world, so you're welcome. They gathered the samples at altitudes of 20,341 feet and 21,818 feet. Each ice core's environment therefore differed in terms of air temperature, UV radiation, and oxygen concentration. These factors undoubtedly influence the microbial communities and reflect different climates from the past. The researchers theorize that as the world's glaciers sink, they will release microbes and viruses that have been frozen in ice for thousands of years, leaving scientists with a lack of preserved specimens to learn from. Even more alarmingly, the team suggests that melting glacier ice could release prehistoric pathogens into the environment. Studies like this are helping scientists better understand viral and microbial evolution. They are also gleaning potentially useful information for developing accurate predictive climate change models based on past events. Antarctic dinosaur. Paleontologists working on frozen Mount Patrick in Antarctica found what they described as an ice fossil popsicle containing the remains of an enormous, previously unknown dinosaur. The new species of sauropodomorph was found over 4,000 feet high. Sauropodomorphs were the biggest things around back then, with this example estimated to be 22 feet long. They had long necks and were herbivores, living in the early Jurassic era some 190 million years ago. This latest find was named Glacialosaurus hammeri in honor of fossil hunter Professor William Hammer. The continent of Antarctica used to be part of what's called the Jurassic Freeway. It refers to a time when territories such as Africa and Australia were joined together and dinos could simply walk between them. It all ended when the land broke up and the climate changed. Antarctica used to be a whole lot warmer and had the perfect climate for creatures and plants to prosper, including this large dinosaur. The strange thing is that this massive G. hammeri was encased in a popsicle made out of rock as well as ice. A dinosaur popsicle. Who knew? The long-ago person. On August 14, 1999, three Canadian sheep hunters discovered human remains on a melting glacier in British Columbia near the Yukon border. Near the man were a walking stick, bones, and a fur garment. The sheep hunters notified authorities at the Beringia Center, a Yukon Territory museum, about their discovery. Because the remains were found in traditional Champagne in Aishihik First Nations territory, their representatives were also notified and dispatched to the site. There, they found the incomplete skeleton of a man whose skull was missing. They named him the long-ago person found in the traditional Champagne in Aishihik language. The First Nations and the British Columbia government jointly agreed to manage the discovery together, ensuring that scientific research could be carried out while respecting indigenous values and customs. Researchers determined that long-ago man lived around 1700 AD, or roughly 300 years ago. He was a young, healthy man between the ages of 17 and 22 when he died, indicating that an unexpected accident took his life. The iron blade knife and spear thrower discovered alongside him suggested he was a hunter. His other personal belongings included a robe made from 95 gopher skins, a beaver skin bag, a walking stick, and a spruce root hat. Digestive tract analysis showed that he ate beach asparagus and shellfish during his last hours, meaning he likely started his journey near saltwater. In fact, he consumed shellfish for most of his life, only switching to meat a month or two prior before he perished. Scientists posited the theory that he grew up near a coast, spent some of his last months in Canada's interior, then once again relocated to the coast shortly before his death. DNA evidence traced the long-ago man to 17 of his living relatives, but researchers are uncertain of his journey's purpose and destination. In 2001, scientists returned the man's remains to the Champagne and Aishihik Nations, who cremated him and returned the ashes to his original resting place. Yukon horses. There's a lot going on in Canada. In 2003, scientists exploring Canada's Yukon Territory spotted a piece of bone jutting out of the frozen ground. It was too old for radiocarbon dating, but it turns out that it was from a horse. The permafrost had preserved some DNA, and when they were finally able to reconstruct its genetic code, they made a shocking discovery. The animal was around 700,000 years old. This changed the game in terms of the equus lineage, all horses, donkeys, and zebras. Experts disagree over their evolution, and you know how intense scientific debates can get. The genus called equus were believed to have been on the planet for around 2 million years. Unlocking the genetic code of the Yukon horse led them to discover it was probably more than that, probably 4 to 4.5 million years. So horses have been here for over 4 million years, and it's partly down to the frozen conditions which kept the Yukon steed in great shape. For science. On another note, gold miners searching the muck along Last Chance Creek stumbled upon a partially frozen carcass of a Yukon horse. The horse had a long piece of hide with hair and mane still attached and some tendons and bones, along with some of the internal organs all preserved by the frozen ground. It was the largest mummified remains ever discovered in the Yukon and can be seen on display at the Yukon-Beringia Interpretive Center. Photos of stranded explorers. In 2013, conservationists with New Zealand's Antarctic Heritage Trust discovered a box containing 100-year-old photo negatives. The team found the unexpected stash in a photographer's darkroom at Scott's Hut, a base at Cape Evans. Because they had sat frozen in a block of ice for so long, restoring the 22 negatives was a delicate process. Conservator Mark Strange gently and painstakingly separated them and cleaned them of mold. Then he developed and digitized the photos. The previously unseen images featured members of the Ross Sea Party, who assisted explorer Sir Ernest Shackleton's failed overland expedition across the continent. Their job was to lay supply lines in anticipation of Shackleton's impending journey. The crew became stranded at Scott's Hut in May 1915, when their ship, the Aurora, blew away during a blizzard. For the next year and a half, the 10-person team lived in the abandoned Scott's Hut, which members of the previous Terra Nova expedition had built. They combated conditions like scurvy, frostbite, and exhaustion while surviving on a starvation diet, at times subsisting on handfuls of dog kibble. Meanwhile, the suffering but dedicated workers continued setting up Shackleton's supply route. During their trips across the ice, their only shelter was a flimsy tent. The extreme circumstances and weather claimed 3 men's lives. The Aurora finally returned for the Ross Sea Party in January 1917, and the 7 weakened survivors sailed back to New Zealand. The negatives discovered in 2013 offered an eerie glimpse at some of the crew, including Chief Scientist Alexander Stevens, and of the ominous landscape they would call home far longer than planned. Message in a bottle. On July 10, 1959, American geologist Paul T. Walker placed a message in a glass bottle and left it at a cairn near a glacier on Ward Hunt Island in Canada's high Arctic. The note requested for the reader to measure the distance between the glacier and the rock formation and mail the information to his lab. Walker's aim was to measure if and how much the glacier retreated. He was ahead of his time, as most of his contemporaries expected the opposite. The cairn was 4 feet away from the glacier when Walker left the message. He never got to watch his experiment unfold as he passed away several months later. 54 years later, in 2013, Laval University researchers Warwick Vincent and Dennis Sarazin discovered the frozen bottle containing Walker's note. They honored the late geologist's wish and determined that the glacier retreated 233 feet since 1954. It's a story about climate change, but it is also a story about the incredibly brave and strong men who worked in this extreme high Arctic environment in the 1950s, back before GPS and sat phone technology, Vincent told Grind TV Outdoor. This is the most remote part of North America and the coldest coastal zone. This also makes the evidence of substantial glacial retreat of great interest. Walker did not necessarily believe the glacier was retreating, but his apparent foresight is chilling, especially at a time when our planet appears to be in the throes of major climate change. The Lendbrain Tunic. In August 2011, archaeologists from Oppland's Glacier Archaeology Rescue Program discovered a bundle of woven fabric on Norway's Lendbrain Glacier at over 6,500 feet above sea level. While hundreds of artifacts have appeared among the country's receding glaciers in recent years, researchers did not find any artifacts nearby, begging the question of what it was and why someone left it behind. Researchers from the University of Oslo and the Norwegian University of Science and Technology examined the item. They identified it as an iron Age tunic from sometime between 230 and 390 AD. At over 1,500 years old, it's the oldest piece of clothing ever discovered in Norway. It's also one of Europe's only surviving garments from the time period. Woven from sheep's wool, the tunic contains several repair patches, meaning someone got their use out of it. In fact, it may have even passed through several owners. A slender man or a boy probably wore the garment based on its size. Its patterns and materials suggest that an expert did not create the tunic, but it took a while to make. At the time, textile production was an inherently time-consuming process, as you can imagine. Reproducing it was also quite a task. Hand weavers spent a combined 760 hours recreating the tunic, which is on display at the Norwegian Mountain Center. Prehistoric seeds. Several years ago, researchers from the Russian Academy of Sciences discovered a cache of 32,000-year-old plant seeds frozen in ice. Known as Silene stenophylla, or the narrow-leafed campion, the flowering species is native to Siberia. An Ice Age squirrel had buried the seeds along the Kolyma River, just like the movie. By the time scientists found them, they were underneath 124 feet of permafrost. The discovery of ancient seeds is perhaps only mildly exciting, but the idea of bringing them to life was both mysterious and intriguing. Unfortunately, the team failed at their first attempt at germinating the campion seeds. But there were several immature seeds which contained viable genetic material. The researchers extracted their tissue and successfully germinated and grew 36 plants in culture dishes. Their shape was different from modern S. stenophylla with the narrower leaves. The flowers eventually grew their own seeds. These results, which were published in a study, suggest that permafrost may contain a gene pool of ancient species waiting to be resurrected. Botanist Elaine Soloway, who grew a date palm from a 2,000-year-old seed, believes resurrecting extinct ancient plants could be useful. Understanding how the S. stenophylla seeds remained viable for 32,000 years can help us preserve our own seeds for potential future use. Any insight gained on seeds which have been frozen and how to thaw them and sprout them is very valuable, Soloway told National Geographic. Naturally, some experts were suspicious about the validity of the Russian team's experiment. The scientists who conducted the study claimed that radiocarbon dating verified the seed's age. Still, some scholars believed it was necessary to conduct further DNA analysis and confirm the radiocarbon test's accuracy. A crashed airplane. An Anchorage-bound Air Force cargo plane crashed into Alaska's Mount Gannett in 1952, tragically claiming all 52 souls aboard. En route from Washington, the C-124 Globemaster aircraft was several miles off course. Civil Air Patrol Lieutenant Terrace Moore found the wreckage 6 days later. Only the plane's tail remained intact, while the rest of it was unrecognizable. The impact triggered a major avalanche, which, along with glacial movement, caused snow and ice to swallow the wreckage. By the following year, an estimated 50 feet of snow had piled onto the site. Nobody saw it again until June 2012, when an Alaska Army National Guard Black Hawk helicopter pilot spotted airplane debris along Colony Glacier while flying overhead. At first, officials believed it was from an unreported recent crash, but a ground search confirmed its true identity. During the 60 years it was missing, the wreckage traveled 13 miles down the glacier, finally emerging from the ice near Lake George. A volunteer military crew travels to the site every June to recover what they can during the month-long window that it's safe to do so. They've retrieved many personal effects, including uniforms, dog tags, wedding rings, and wallets. The crew has also uncovered 37 of the passengers' remains, bringing much-needed closure to their surviving family members. Parts of the airplane continue to resurface, as well as packed belongings. Air Force officials concluded that poor weather and unsophisticated instrumentation caused pilot navigational error, resulting in the crash. Hairy sea monster. Residents of the coastal Pakhachi village on the northeastern Kamchatka Peninsula in Russia's Far East were baffled when in 2018, a huge, hairy, putrid-smelling sea monster washed ashore. The Siberian Times reported it was more than 3 times the size of a man, with dirty chalk coloring, and it appears to have a long tail or tentacle, but no definitive head or eyes as it lies on the dark volcanic sand. Local resident Svetlana Diadenko recorded the hairy sea beast and posted it on social media. She said, "The most interesting thing to me is that the creature is covered with tubular fur. Could it be some ancient creature?" Some people did, in fact, wonder if it was a woolly mammoth carcass that had been released by melting permafrost, but Diadenko rejected the idea, stating that it looked more like a hairy octopus. It does look like it has the type of fur found on a polar bear, but it also looks like it has a long tail or a tentacle, making it look pretty bizarre. Marine biologist Sergei Kornev told the Siberian Times that the decaying remains were probably the partial corpse of a whale. Under the influence of the sea, time, and various animals from the smallest to the largest, a whale often takes on bizarre forms. For now, it remains a globster, basically a sea creature that is just a former blob or glob of what it once was with no apparent bone structure. While globsters look like they are made of lots of weird tentacles and things, they aren't usually covered in hair. The silvery serpent. In October 2013, marine science instructor Jasmine Santana discovered an 18-foot-long eel-like creature while snorkeling off the California coast with colleagues. The teacher, who works at the Catalina Island Marine Institute, spotted the glimmering sea monster about 30 feet underwater. Altogether, it took 16 people to drag the huge animal to shore. What was this creepy, long alien creature? While it sounds like something straight out of a science fiction novel, the creature turned out to be an oarfish, a deep-sea dweller that plunges to depths of 3,000 feet or more. Oarfish can reach over 50 feet long and are the world's longest bony fish species. It's likely that these giants inspired historical legends of sea serpents. Because sightings are rare, oarfish are largely understudied. "We've never seen a fish this big," explained Mark Waddington, senior captain of CME's sail training ship, the Tol Moor. "The last oarfish we saw was 3 feet long." The fish appeared to have died from natural causes. Tissue samples and video were sent to biologists at the University of California, Santa Barbara for further study. 5 days after Santana's discovery, a group of third graders spotted a 14-foot-long oarfish carcass on the beach in the city of Oceanside. The highly unusual consecutive discoveries perplexed scientists. Milton Love, a research biologist at the University of California, suspected that a strong current carried both fish toward the shore and that they died battling powerful swells. Texas sea monster. In the wake of Hurricane Harvey in 2017, a science communicator with the Audubon Society named Preeti Desai captured an image of a beached lump of flesh in Texas City, Texas. She consulted the Twitter community for help identifying the creature, which Forbes columnist Girl Scientist described as looking like a poorly made sausage with teeth. Ugh. The writer got in touch with ichthyologist Benjamin Frabel from the Scripps Institute of Oceanography. Frabel confirmed that he and his colleagues believe the carcass belonged to a fanged-toothed snake eel, also known as a tusky eel. These guys are not commonly spotted, that's for sure. This species typically dwells in the Gulf of Mexico at depths between 100 and 300 feet, but Harvey's strong winds and flooding likely washed this one ashore. While experts can't be sure that the specimen is 100% a tusky eel due to its advanced state of decomposition and bloating, all signs point toward it being some type of eel. A DNA test could have definitively identified the species, but no samples were taken from the animal, who was left at the site to rest in peace. Prehistoric monster fish. A bizarre and scary-looking creature caught Stephanie Hall's eye in 2018 during her weekly jog in New Jersey's Island Beach State Park. It was between 4 and 5 feet long and covered in hard armor-like scales. Hall described the shocking experience in an interview with app.com, stating, "I thought it was a lizard or a Komodo dragon at first. I froze in my tracks because I was not expecting something that big or that strange looking." The woman had jogged away from the shore to avoid a seal when she found herself face to face with the cadaver. Sounds like a scary beach, jeez. The sighting was also a first for Island Beach State Park officer Louis Derflinger, who initially mistook the creature as a shark. He identified it as an Atlantic sturgeon after realizing it lacked the customary top fin of a shark. Sturgeons are highly endangered prehistoric fish that have been around for at least 200 million years. They grow up to 14 feet long and weigh as much as 800 pounds, according to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. When they say prehistoric, it certainly looks like it's something out of the deep, beachgoer David Transu told app.com. A century ago, there were over 100,000 sturgeons in the area, as well as a burgeoning caviar industry, which relied on the fish's eggs for product. This caused the sturgeon population to suffer heavily, and in 1998, the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission imposed a 40-year moratorium on harvesting Atlantic sturgeons. Recovery, and the nearly extinct Atlantic sturgeon continues to barely cling to its several hundred million year existence. And now for number 7, but first, it's shout-out time! Big thank you to Destiny Stevens and Muzzle Flash for their nice comments! Hope you're all having a good day, and be sure to subscribe and let me know if you'd like a shout-out in the comments below! Nessie's little brother.
Scottish couple Margaret and Nick Flippance stumbled upon the terrifying, partially skeletonized, curled-up remains of an unknown creature while walking along an Aberdeen beach in 2011. The rotting 30-foot-long carcass, which had a large head full of sharp teeth and a tail, was unrecognizable. Mr. Flippance told The Sun, "It's nothing like we've ever seen. It almost looks prehistoric." A mammal curator from Scotland's Natural History Museum confirmed that the nightmarish creature was probably a long-finned pilot whale. Marine life expert Rob Devil of the London Zoo echoed this theory, saying that the remains could belong to a killer whale or a small pilot whale. While some cryptozoology fanatics insisted that the animal was definitely a sea monster, it was most likely an ordinary creature that was pretty far along in the decomposition process. It died a long time ago, and tides caused the body to wash ashore, whale expert Mark Simmons explained in an interview with The Sun. New Zealand sea monster. Following violent thunderstorms in 2013, New Zealanders discovered a mysterious decaying carcass on Pukehina Beach at the Bay of Plenty, about 120 miles southeast of Auckland. A local resident named Elizabeth Ann captured video footage of the creature, which she described as having a huge head and teeth with rudimentary flippers. Beyond that, much of its body was missing. It seems about 9 meters in length, but the lower part of the body is probably mainly entrails from an attack. Unsure what the animal was, locals and social media users speculated that it could be a saltwater crocodile, a dolphin, a giant moray eel, or even a dinosaur. Anton von Helden, a marine animal expert, disagreed with all of these suggestions. Instead, he leaned toward the more realistic possibility that it was a killer whale, citing its distinct flipper as the giveaway clue. This is likely the case, as killer whales are common in the Bay of Plenty. Moreover, these predators have sharp, cone-like teeth, which are consistent with the gory remains. A brain-like blob. When Charleston, South Carolina resident Alexander Ilg recently happened upon a squishy pink brain-like organism at Folly Beach, he took to social media to try identifying it. The various guesses were a true testament to the blob's unattractive appearance and included whale snot, a sea alien, a severed body part, a tiger shark brain, and a massive wad of chewed gum. It was none of the above, and Ilg is just one of many people who have seen these creatures and wondered what they are. The fleshy salmon-colored mass is called sea pork. It's a member of the tunicate family, which consists of some 3,000 species of rubbery, gelatinous organisms. Although sea porks have confused and grossed out beachgoers for decades, they're surprisingly common. They come in a variety of colors, including pink, purple, and beige, and are found in many places throughout the world. Sea porks are especially common along the southern U.S. coast, particularly in western Florida, where the waves and currents are notorious for washing things onto beaches. They also often attach themselves to jetties and boats. Sea porks feed by pumping surrounding ocean water into their body, filtering food particles from it, and squirting the water back out. While sea porks are not monstrously huge, many people consider these organ-like glistening invertebrates to be terrifying in their own right due to their slimy appearance. Even the Tampa Bay Times once referred to them as maybe the grossest sea creatures ever. What do you think? Do you agree? Let me know in the comments below. Sea porks may look unappealing, but they are harmless, and in South Korea, some tunicate species are even considered culinary delicacies. Yum! The Muriwai Monster. In December 2016, an observant New Zealander named Melissa Doubleday spotted what looked like a giant whale carcass as she drove past Muriwai Beach, roughly 25 miles northwest of Auckland. The sight compelled her enough to pull over for a closer look, which ultimately left the woman with more questions than answers. The bulky, several-meter-long object was completely covered with shells and dark tentacles. Resident Rani Timoti said, "It's got a putrid smell when you're downwind, and when you look closely, it looks like wiggling worms." Doubleday snapped some pictures and, like almost everybody does nowadays, reached out to the online community for help figuring out what it was. Most people were equally as baffled and slightly amused by this strange sight and suggested that it was a Rastafarian whale, an alien time capsule, an ancient canoe, or a beach Christmas tree. The mystery was solved thanks to the New Zealand Marine Sciences Society, who identified the heaping mass as a piece of driftwood covered in filter-feeding crustaceans called goose barnacles, which spend their entire lives attached to submerged objects. In Portugal and Spain, goose barnacles are considered a culinary delicacy. The dreadlock-covered driftwood drew large crowds to the beach, but the excitement didn't last long. A few days after it appeared, Doubleday wrote on her Facebook page, "Everything on it has died now, and it smells really bad." Altamahaha. A man in Georgia, USA, named Jeff Warren and his son were walking along Wolf Island Beach in 2018 when they noticed a prehistoric-looking dead animal with a small head and elongated neck. At first, Warren claimed he believed it was a decomposing eel carcass. He posted photos and videos of it on social media, sparking suspicions that the creature was the legendary Altamahaha, or Alti, which is more or less Georgia's version of the Loch Ness Monster. Stories about Alti began circulating during the 1820s when a sea captain claimed that a marine monster attacked his ship and crew. The creature Warren found gained widespread local media coverage, and it wasn't long before the Georgia Department of Natural Resources got involved in hopes of solving the mystery behind its identity. Officials closely examined Warren's photographs and determined that the entire ordeal was a hoax. The agency released a list of reasons for their decision, including footprints that appear to have been wiped away, indicating an attempt to conceal the deliberate placement of the so-called monster. A stiff tail, which was likely made from papier-mâché or a similar material, the suspected use of fish organs in staging the scene, and no close-up photographs of the animal. They also found it a tad shady that Warren supposedly abandoned the faux corpse at the scene without contacting the authorities or anyone else who could have turned it over to a lab for further analysis. Even more suspiciously, as the details of the fraud surfaced, Warren suddenly made himself scarce, and the media could no longer locate or contact him. Maybe he just didn't want the media attention. Some argued that he was being harassed mercilessly for his discovery. A rumor went around that a local author faked Warren's identity and the discovery as a publicity stunt to promote his recent book about the Altamahaha. The author admitted to being in the area when the phony carcass was discovered, what a coincidence, but denied accusations that he was involved in the whole thing. The New Jersey Monster. In 2011, a 23-year-old New Jersey fisherman named Doug Cutler speared an eel-like creature that perhaps resembled something from the morbid inner workings of Stephen King's imagination. At 3 feet long and weighing only 4.5 pounds, the serpentine animal was not too intimidating in size. Nevertheless, with its large suction cup-like mouth, which is lined with several circular rows of small, sharp teeth, and the holes along its cartilaginous, greenish-brown body, Cutler's Raritan River catch is truly terrifying. After Cutler's friend posted photos of the creepy creature on Reddit, many people alleged that the images were doctored. But the photos were no hoax. The animal is a sea lamprey, a parasitic fish that has survived 4 mass extinction events and remains virtually unchanged since it first appeared in the fossil record 340 million years ago. Sea lampreys are native to the Atlantic Ocean, but often travel up freshwater rivers to spawn. There are also invasive populations in several water bodies throughout the US, including the Great Lakes. The sea lamprey latches onto its prey with its vacuum-like mouth, digs its teeth into its victim for extra grip, and rips the creature's skin and gills off using its sharp tongue. Then it feeds like a leech by secreting an enzyme that prevents the prey's blood from clotting while ingesting its bodily fluids. Creepy? Yes, and also very, very real. The Chilean blob. We've seen our fair share of sea creature blobs, but perhaps the Chilean blob is the most famous of all. The Chilean blob was a large mass of tissue discovered on Pinuno Beach in Los Muermos, Chile in July 2003. It weighed a whopping 14 tons and measured 39 feet across. Some say it was the remains of a giant octopus, though nothing was ever proven nor confirmed. In June 2004, it was reported that fragments of DNA found in the blob had been found to match that of a sperm whale. Though this was reported, many didn't believe it had actually been analyzed, and people thought it was fake. This isn't the first time Chile has seen a globster either. Back in 1896, a similar case hit the headlines, though this too never had a confirmed explanation. Could they be the same species? A whale? An octopus? Or something new to us? What if it is an ancient creature that is so old we don't have the technology to detect its origins? You never know with a sea monster. The City of Gyrzu. The ancient city of Gyrzu is thought to have been first inhabited around 6,500 years ago, and at one point became the capital of the Lagash Kingdom, a very important Sumerian city. It was the first place to provide evidence of the amazing Sumerian civilization. Located in southern Iraq between the Tigris and Euphrates rivers, excavations of the Sumerian site began in 1877. Amongst the artifacts that were found at the site, such as stone sculptures and silver ornaments, there were as many as 40,000 cuneiform tablets, which offered a wealth of information about the little-known Sumerian civilization. Unfortunately, most of the ruins at Girzu were systematically looted, and many of the tablets were stolen to be sold on the black market or to private collections before archaeologists were able to take them to safety. Only around 4,000 were ever officially uncovered by archaeologists. Translating them has, however, proved to be difficult because the carvings represent a form of written language unlike anything else that has been found. With just a small fraction of the entire collection being available to study, it's still not been possible to decipher most of the texts more than 100 years after they were unearthed. Those that can be read are archives with records of possessions, such as how many sheep and cattle each farmer owned. But there's hope that some of the clay tablets have more interesting information. Could they hold the secrets to the long-lost civilization? And might they explain what happened to the residents of the city and why it seems to have been evacuated in the 2nd century BC? We might only truly find out once some of the missing ones are finally returned. Some other mysterious artifacts found were the statue of Gudea, the king priest of Lagash carved in diorite, which was carved in a style that was unknown to Mesopotamia at that time. There are many statues of him and his deep religiousness and achievements. Other statues were also found of the goddess Bau, a Babylonian goddess of healing. The Klerksdorp spheres. As far as we know, humans have only been on this planet for around 200,000 years, but occasionally a discovery is made that forces us to rethink everything we know. One of the most mysterious artifacts of all time are the Klerksdorp spheres. Hundreds of these round objects have been found by miners near Oudtshoorn in South Africa. Collected from pyrophyllite deposits around 3 billion years old, they are often cited as out-of-place objects. There was a story that a man brought one of the spheres to NASA. After NASA tested the stone, they said that the only way this stone could be created was in zero gravity, because its balance was too perfect to be created on Earth, and the spheres were harder than steel. It is hard to verify any of these claims, of course, but pseudo-archaeologists use these as an example that intelligent beings roamed the Earth billions of years ago and made these spheres for military or religious purposes. Perhaps the spheres were an ancient form of information technology. They range from half a centimeter to 10 centimeters in size and are not actually perfectly round. They vary in shape from flattened spheres to well-defined discs. Geologists and scientists argue that these spheres are a result of natural processes. They show how voids can be created in the Earth by bacterial activity, and once they are subsequently filled in with hot rock due to volcanic activity, they act as molds for structures like these. They are mostly composed of hematite and pyrite and originated as concretions like many other strange spherical shapes found around the world. So, were they formed naturally, or were they made by ancient beings in the past? If that's the case, then how did they end up in a deposit that's so old? And is this proof that there was an ancient civilization that existed far earlier than anyone had thought? Let me know what you think in the comments below. Ranmasu Uyana. Within the ancient sacred city of Anuradhapura in Sri Lanka is a 40-acre garden called Ranmasu Uyana. It's full of monuments and structures that date back as far as the 3rd century BC. But there is one thing in particular that has confused scientists ever since it was first seen, a carving on a rock that appears to depict an unusual chart-like map that's called the Stargate. A Stargate is believed to be a gateway between the Earth and outer space and is how humans and other intelligent beings communicate. Opposite the Stargate are four seats, and it's been suggested that people would sit in these where they could manipulate the map and use it to travel vast distances to other worlds in the universe. It's said to be similar to other engravings that have been found in Egypt and Peru, and there are some that believe that they are evidence of an extraterrestrial presence on Earth. They would come and take resources such as gold back to their home planet. Each of these stargates has been found near a large body of water, which in the case of Ranmasu Uyana is a series of ponds that are maintained by a complex hydraulic mechanism. So could this be an ancient technique? Of course, the fact that this is the prevailing theory is evidence of how little we truly know about these carvings and the cultures who made them. It's much more likely that there's a more down-to-earth explanation for them, but as of yet, no one has any clue what it might be. Statue with worm. The Medici Chapel in Florence, Italy, are two structures in the Basilica of San Lorenzo dating back to the 16th and 17th centuries. They are three burial places built to honor the Medici family, but the highlight is Michelangelo's new sacristy. The entire room was designed by Michelangelo himself over a 14-year period to honor four members of the Medici family who had died. Michelangelo spent his teen years with the Medici, and as he built the chapel, he reflected on his life. As he turned 50, he wrote that he was feeling old, tired, and depressed. While all of this is interesting and sculptures and art impressive, one of the strangest things ever is this statue of Roman armor with some sort of strange creature coming out of the neck. Located in a hallway right before Michelangelo's new sacristy, this statue is very hard to understand. Is it a torso with sleeves? Is it an armor breastplate? People have described the thing in the neck as a worm or even a caterpillar, but perhaps if you look at it differently, it might also be the top of a spinal cord. There is very little information about this sculpture, so if you have any guesses as to what it is and what you think the thing represents, let us know in the comments below. The Kola Peninsula Pyramids. The most famous pyramids in the world are undoubtedly the ones in Egypt, but many pyramids have been found across the planet after being built by various ancient civilizations. The oldest known pyramid, however, isn't in Egypt or South America like you might think, but it's actually in Russia on the Kola Peninsula. At first, it appears like this is just an image of the landscape, but the closer you look at the mountains, the more clear it becomes that these have been made by hand. They are step pyramids, and by some accounts are almost twice as old as the ones in the Giza Necropolis. The Kola Peninsula is actually full of evidence of an ancient society, and besides the pyramids, there are a series of labyrinths also carved into the ground. Very little is known about the people who made them, especially as the region is virtually entirely within the Arctic Circle and is therefore extremely cold and often covered in ice. Some experts believe that the Kola Peninsula is the true birthplace of humanity. To the Greeks, Hyperborea was a faraway land where the sun shone for 6 months a year and would have been a perfect country. The Hyperboreans may have been a highly developed society, with some saying they knew the secret of atomic energy and how to build flying machines. The discoveries from the Kola Peninsula may confirm the idea that early humans came from the north, and some sort of catastrophe forced them to migrate. The purpose of these pyramids is unclear. They don't appear to be burial sites like other places like this, but are instead thought to be markers for ancient sailors or for use in religious rituals. Until further artifacts are discovered, we may never know much about the people who once lived here, and it remains one of the greatest archaeological mysteries of our time. Medieval sword. This sword, which dates from the 13th century, was found in the River Witham in the UK in 1825, but despite almost 200 years of study, it's still unclear who made it or what the letters on it mean. It's 38 inches long, weighs 2 pounds and 10 ounces, and is made of steel. It's double-edged, so is clearly designed to be used in battle, but on one side is a mysterious inscription that's been made from gold wire that was inlaid into the steel. What this code means is completely unknown, and the British Library has even reached out to the public for any help with deciphering it, so if you have any ideas, let us know! There have been suggestions that it might be an incantation to bring good fortune to whoever wields it, or it could simply be the name of the person who commissioned the sword. What do you think it says? Or what would you write on a sword? Let me know in the comments below. The Concho Stone. The Concho Stone is a mysterious slab of rock that's covered in carvings from the Stone Age. It was originally found in Scotland in 1887, but was buried in 1965 to protect it from vandals. The stone was only recently uncovered again, and despite archaeologists knowing far more than they did back then, it's still not clear what the purpose of this stone was. It's regarded as one of the most important historical treasures in Scotland and is more than 5,000 years old. It measures 42 feet by 26 feet, and there are more than 90 spirals, indentations, and other carvings that include a ringed cross and what appear to be a pair of four-toed feet. The cup and ring symbols have been found at other Neolithic sites around Europe, and while they're thought to possibly be location markers, no one's certain. Was this simply a signpost, or did it have a much greater significance to the people who created it? Stone face. When Tom Gibbons, a farm owner from North Carolina, arranged for one of his fields to be plowed in 2019, he didn't expect to find anything unusual. After all, this field had been used for as long as he could remember, but suddenly his farmhand hit a rock in the ground. Not thinking anything of it, he dug the rock out and threw it to one side so he could continue his work. But when Gibbons walked past and saw it, he realized it was more than just a rock. Measuring 2 feet long by 1.5 feet wide, he brushed off the dirt and found to his amazement that it was a stone carving of a face. He contacted the local archaeological institute to try to find out more about it, but they were as surprised as he was. They had no idea when it was made or who would have created it, as nothing else like it has ever been found in the state. They took scans of it and found that it was made from sandstone, and so far all they've been able to do is post the images online in the hope that someone may come forward with more information. Could this be an ancient carving from a long-lost community or something else? Until more objects like it are found, we may never know. The Pyramid of Djoser. The pyramids at Giza are known around the world for their magnificence, but they wouldn't have been possible if it wasn't for the construction of another pyramid, the first the Egyptians ever constructed at Saqqara. It was built around 4,700 years ago and is known as the Pyramid of Djoser, or Djoser, after the Egyptian king from the 3rd dynasty. The design of the step pyramid was attributed to Imhotep, the pharaoh's chancellor or vizier who became famous for his accomplishments. More people remember him than many of the country's rulers. He was also the high priest of the sun god Ra, and it's quite likely that his true agenda behind the construction of the pyramid was for religious purposes and not as a burial place for his master. As a historical figure, we know very little about him, but following his death, he became deified and people honored him as a great author. The structure is 197 feet tall, contains 11.6 million cubic feet of stone and clay, and sits on top of an underground labyrinth of tunnels that stretch around 3.5 miles long. There are also a number of dummy buildings designed to trick potential thieves and passageways that seem to lead to nowhere. Could it be possible that there's far more to learn about this site and that there are many more secrets hidden within it? Many believe so, and it could hold the key to understanding how the pyramids were built and what their true purposes were. The Wari Civilization. In Peru's Huanta province, at an altitude of more than 9,000 feet, lies the ruins of Wari, what was once the capital city of the Wari civilization. They ruled the area approximately between the years 500 and 900, and researchers have managed to learn a lot about them. There is evidence, for example, that the stone structures here were once covered in a layer of white plaster, so it would have looked incredible as the sun's light reflected off. But there are some mysteries among the rubble, too. The first is a collection of elongated skulls that are yet to be identified. It's thought that they are the result of a ritual practice that saw people's heads being bound from a young age that causes the skulls to form differently to normal, but without further evidence, it's impossible to know for sure. The other mystery can be seen in a number of rocks across the site. They have grooves and circular holes cut into them, but it's not clear what their purpose was. It would represent a significant technological advancement for a Bronze Age civilization to be able to make these, and they almost look as if they connect together to make pipes. Right now, any theory is just guesswork, and it's hoped one day further clues will be found that solve the mystery once and for all. The Sabu Disk. In 1936, Egyptologist Walter Brian Emery was exploring the 5,000-year-old tomb of Sabu when he found something very unusual. Now known as the Sabu Disk, it's 24 inches in diameter and up to 4 inches thick, and has been made from an extremely fragile material called meta-siltstone. Using this material to form complex shapes would be difficult with modern technology, let alone what was available at the time this was created, so you have to wonder how and why this was made. There are no concrete explanations, but one of the more interesting suggestions is that this was used to harness megalithic energy and could have been a form of battery. By placing water into the three lobes, it's believed by some that it could have interacted with cosmic microwave background energy from throughout the universe and created a circuit. If this is true, then it would show that the ancient Egyptians were far more technologically advanced than we ever thought, and in some ways had access to technology beyond what we have today. It could, of course, have simply been a ceremonial bowl used to share a drink or an offering to the gods, so until others are found or the instructions are discovered, it'll likely remain the source of debate for many years to come. Thanks for watching! Which mystery was your favorite? Do you have any answers to these? Let me know in the comments below, and be sure to subscribe if you haven't already. See you next time! Bye!